what sort of information and knowledge and skills you will get during my lectures. And this is now is the time to ask all sorts of questions and to express all expectations that you have, so that I might introduce certain corrections into my course of lectures and into the material that I'm going to present to you, to make it more profitable for you as future workers of business. Well, let's shut the door also, okay? So, first of all, you need to understand that doing business is mostly about understanding how to sell, what to sell, to whom to sell, well, your market, and at the same time, that is very important, you understand that modern business is unthinkable without texts. All business is about texts. They have texts. When you come to the office, until the moment when you leave the office, you keep writing and reading and commenting and writing and reading and commenting all the time. And this means that you have to be, to a certain extent, linguists, and to a considerable extent, philologists. And because, surprisingly enough, and I will explain why, modern successful businessmen, they're very, very careful about the way they express their ideas and messages through the text in what they write. These are letters, annual reports, presentations, financial statements, limiting conditions, contracts, agreements. About 7 years ago, a friend of mine asked me to come to one of the leading consulting companies that works in Moscow. This is Deloitte. Some of you probably know this company. There are four companies that are rendering a similar type of service. That is called Big Four. You probably heard. Can you name these Big Four companies? Do you know? Right. So yes, Deloitte, Ernst & Young, KPMG, and PricewaterhouseCoopers. So these are the four companies that are doing most of the writing. So a friend of mine came to me and said that Deloitte wants me to come and teach them English. But when I came just to get acquainted with people who actually worked there, I was told that the partner of the company wants to speak to me because he wants to know what sort of information I'm going to give to the staff. And when we were talking, quite of a sudden, he said to me, "Why don't you come and work for Deloitte?" I said, "Igor, I'm professor of Moscow University. I can't leave my work." He said, "No problem. You will work when you want. You come and work in the office, or you can work from home. So we need a linguist." That was a great surprise for me. I say, "Why do you need a linguist for Deloitte?" And he was the partner in charge of financial advisory services and valuation. We're going to speak about valuation a little bit today, therefore you will know what it actually means. And if there are certain terms, by the way, and terms that you don't understand, just write them down, because later on you may ask me about these terms in Basecamp and that system that way we're going to get registered. So he said to me that they need a linguist because he's not satisfied with the quality of the reports they are writing, so the quality of the client documents. And I said, "But I'm not an economist. I don't understand anything in what you're writing." He said, "I don't care about you understanding or not understanding. What I care about is the quality of the Russian and the English language." So I decided to go there, and because at that time I had a certain period, a gap in my teaching, we have the opportunity in Moscow University to take a period of about 3 or 4 months, a kind of a break, in order to write the book or to develop a research course, anything of the sort. So I thought that I will be working there about probably a month or so. I will have a look at the reports, give them certain recommendations, and then I will leave. And so I came to work in Deloitte, and instead of staying there a month, I worked there 10 years. So that's incredible. I worked in Deloitte 10 years. When I came there and when I opened the first report, I realized that I don't understand anything, and this was mostly not because I didn't understand the terminology, but because the quality of the language was horrible. It was just unacceptable. People were expressing their ideas in such a muddled manner that actually, in order to understand what they're saying, more than that, actually consulting, giving their client companies advice about how to develop business or about how to value business adequately, they had to write more clearly. But in fact, sometimes you would come across a very long sentence about 12 lines long. Can you imagine a sentence 12 lines long? Or, for example, repeating the same idea again and again, 2 or 3 or 10 times, sometimes very inconsistently, sometimes inconsistently using the terminology. And it was actually horrible. And then I realized that, in fact, I had to do two things. On the one hand, I had to rewrite many of the reports. Just rewrite. And sometimes when I was given a piece of paper to rewrite or to edit, I switched on this track changes option. You know this option in Microsoft Word, where you switch on track changes and then you can see all the corrections made in the documents. Sometimes the amount of changes that I made to the professional reports made by Deloitte, one of the biggest advisory companies in the world, was 80%. 80% of the text rewritten totally by a linguist, not by a consultant, not by a financial specialist, not by the economist, but by a linguist. Isn't it horrible? This means that, and I was told by the partner of the company saying, Marklen, we invite you not just as an editor, but we invite you as a quality bearer. This means never ever bring to me never ever allow the report to reach my eyes and ears before you actually cleaned all the mistakes there. So I was the final bearer before the partner of the company actually signed the document. And when there were 2 or 3 mistakes that I actually noticed there, actually all criticism was on me, not on his people, but on me. He said, how dared you to give this report to me with such and such mistakes and so on and so forth. Therefore, I had to do also the second time, the second kind of work. And this second kind of work was teaching people to write correctly. So that's what I'm still doing. After leaving Deloitte in 2008, I continue to teach people and to give consultations to people working in different companies, explaining to them how a certain text should be written in such a manner that it would be clearly understood. The first thing that is very important in order to write correctly and efficiently in such a manner that the information becomes clear and lucid and transparent is a very clear idea, is the very, very clear vision of what you want to say. Because very often people begin to say without understanding what will be the final product, without understanding what sort of message they're actually delivering to the customers. Do you understand me? Am I not speaking too quickly? Shall I slow down a little bit? No? Is it fine? So I'm trying to make my, I'm trying to adapt my language to the not to Deloitte, but to this audience. I hope I will be understood easily. Teaching people to express their ideas in the most efficient way, in such a manner that even the most uneducated of them would understand what some other consultants actually said. When you want to see better for yourselves how businessmen themselves see this process, I would recommend you strongly, in the first place, to go and see and read one of the gurus of modern investment and a person who is devoting a lot of time to writing and to good quality is Warren Buffett. You're probably familiar with his name, and you know this, that Warren Buffett is one of the most successful investors in the world. And he's the person who is writing a lot and talking a lot about the necessity to write and to present things very clearly for the clients and for the audience to understand him. In one of the brochures that I'm going to give to you also for the analysis later on, at a later stage, he was writing with the head of the SEC commission. Have you heard the name SEC? No? SEC is Securities Exchange Commission. It's the leading controlling organ in the United States that is controlling the securities market. You don't know the word securities, and you have no idea of the word securities, probably. But this is something that I'm going to explain to you also, little by little. And there he writes, when you start writing on business, imagine you're talking, well, I imagine that I'm talking to my small daughters. So I'm trying to bring down my idea, my business ideas, to the level when you can actually explain and bring home your ideas to the people who are very, very small, uneducated, who know nothing about this. You need to learn to simplify this, bring this level to that, to bring this idea to that level of simplicity. And therefore, whenever you have certain great ideas, and in the future as well, remember about one simple formula that I would recommend you strongly to repeat to yourselves again and again. And this formula is, can I teach anyone this? Just ask yourself this question. If you have some great ideas about developing a business or starting a business or developing a certain research program or asking for a grant, for example, for performing a certain program or development, ask yourself a question. Can I teach anyone this specific idea? And then you can invite somebody, a friend of yours or a relative of yours, and try to explain it. And if you see that the person does not understand it, then blame yourself for not being able to actually formulate the idea very clearly. A week ago, I received an interesting task from one of the partners of Runa Capital. This is a company that is investing a lot in startups and quite successful with small and medium-sized business here in Russia. But he's working in Singapore, and he is one of the two people who has the citizenship in Singapore, Sergei Belousov. He's the partner of his own company, Acronis. And a week ago, they sent me his article that he wrote for RBK about how to hire people. Well, I looked at the article, it was just 5 pages, and I thought that the task was rather simple, and I asked my people to translate. I have a translation company, and I asked my people to translate this text into English. When we sent it to them, their reaction was unacceptable. I said, okay, unacceptable. Then I wrote back to them saying, all right, this time it will be translated by the native speaker. A native speaker, a friend of mine, a person who lives in England all her life, although she's Russian by origin, but actually she speaks English as her second language. She translated it into English, and we sent it again to Sergei. And we had the answer. We had a response from him. He said, your English is beautiful, but you lost all sense. I said, okay. I say, this time I will invite the second editor, a native speaker, who will reread and re-edit this article once again. So I invite a highly qualified English editor, Chris, who lives in London, who doesn't know Russian, but who has a very good command of English and who knows how to bring this text to a very good quality. He edited it, and the reaction was, your English has become even better, but you didn't render my message. It was the third attempt, and the article, believe me, it was not difficult. It was just about the art of hiring people, how to do it most efficiently and not to make mistakes. It was really very, very clear and lucid for me. Then I called Sergei and said, Sergei, let's organize a conference call. He will actually explain what you wanted to say. And we had a conference call. One person was in London, another person was in Singapore, another person was in Korea, and I was here in Moscow. So this was a conference call where we were discussing one small article about 5 pages long. We were discussing, and he said to me, your main mistake in translating my article was that you think that I want to criticize someone in hiring your personnel, in hiring your staff. He said, but I do not want to criticize anyone. I want just to explain that some people are very good performers and other people are not very good performers. How do you understand the word performer? Yes, but by performer we mean not just исполнитель. By performer we mean somebody who actually performs. Actually, by performer we mean a successful executive. A successful executive. So he said, I don't want to say that somebody is a star, somebody is not a star. I just want to say that some people who are very good performers, they think only and mostly about how to get a good career, how to get a good growth in the company, and not actually thinking about the profits of the company. When he explained everything, and he said, please use a very polite and soft language, do not try to criticize anyone, and whenever you notice some very difficult words, smooth it down. Okay, then I said on the phone, I said, guys, do you understand everything that Sergei has said right now? They said, yes, Chris, Olga, Anna, they have understood everything. And then I said, all right, I'll give you one more day to polish it up. This morning, I received this article again, polished, after Chris and Olga and Anna. I spent an hour and a half polishing it again. Again, later on, I will give you this article for polishing, and then we shall see how you will polish it. And then we shall see what you achieve. I will give you the first variant, and the second variant, and the third variant, and then I will not show you the final variant before you actually do your work. While I was polishing, I realized that these translators and editors failed to do this just for a sole reason of not reading their work aloud. That was their mistake. They were not reading their work aloud. And then I had to call them explaining the importance of reading a very important piece of work aloud. When you are reading to yourselves, to your mind, what is the way for you, for the people who are estimating the quality of what you are reading, to mark the significance of a certain word or a certain phrase when you read it to yourselves? How do you do it? If you think that a certain word is important or a certain phrase is important, or you think that a certain phrase is expressively marked, what do you mentally do in order to mark it in your mind as being important, significant, for the understanding of the whole piece? What do you do? In your mind. Repeat. In your mind. So read again, read again, read again, right? Is that what you're doing? Or maybe there is anything else? Just general idea. But if you catch the general idea, then again, you lose the opportunity to mark, to highlight a certain word as significant, as important. As a result, you are not capable of organizing the vertical connection of the important words that you come across in sentence one, sentence two, sentence three, sentence four. You want a vertical connection, right? Only when you understand these things vertically, you can see the general image of what you're saying, the Gestalt. Gestalt means the general image, is a German word, but the general image of what you are reading. But when you are reading something aloud, even to yourselves, you have lots of instruments to highlight something and to emphasize something. It is mostly done through intonation and timbre and pauses, right, and speed and tempo. You are using all sorts of instruments to do this. And when you are reading, half aloud to yourselves, you are sort of building sense. You are making a sense of what you are reading. You read a sentence, then you read the second sentence, then you read the third sentence. Imagine the following sentence. Let me give you an example. The Russian example. Я хочу по причине страшной жажды, возникшей в результате потребления соленых огурцов, которые привезла моя тетка из Краснодара. А Краснодар — великолепный, красивый город. Там много замечательных людей, великолепных людей. Девушки там очень красивые. Глаз невозможно отвести. Такие кубанские казачки, такие замечательные. Выпить чаю. So, well, what did I do? I actually broke suddenly something. Well, the two words that should be connected, я хочу, выпечаю, with something huge. Can you imagine it? Can you imagine a text that is written not on the general subject, but on a very serious subject? When you have such an insertion, what happens to your what happens to your brain?
It blows.
And then you, and if you have one sentence and another sentence and a third sentence like that, by the end of the text, you say, I cannot make head or tail of it. I don't understand anything at all in this text. Because you will have to always reconstruct the sense that exists in this text through half reading. You need to say, я хочу выпить чаю. I say, ah, I understand. You need actually to move your lips and to move your tongue in order to make the sense of this text. Otherwise, it becomes very, very difficult. Only with your eyes to connect these things becomes nearly impossible. Well, and sadly enough, and you will see it yourselves when you graduate from the university, I think about 60% of texts in modern business is like this. About 60% of texts. Just be prepared. I'm just warning you, be prepared for that. And do not trust every text that is given to you as an example, even if it is written by the president of the company. Sometimes the president of the company writes so poorly, sometimes, that you also have to make additional effort to understand what it meant. Therefore, the first skill that you will be developing while attending my lectures here is the skill of making sense of what you are reading. And when I said making sense of what you are reading, this means that every sentence that you would be reading in the material that I'm giving you here during these lectures will be a barrier. And please do not leave this barrier without understanding it. First, understand. If you need to read 20 times the same sentence, read 20 times. But don't go without understanding. You may curse the writer, saying that the writer is stupid and poor and uneducated, but don't leave this sentence. And then try sometimes to rewrite it. All right, let me give you some sort of an example of what sort of understanding you should have in order to consider yourselves capable of producing good English. Good English that is devoted on business. Let me show you a fragment of a video. There is a whole series of programs on the American and on the British TV called Apprentice Number One. What is apprentice? How do you understand the word? Apprentice? Подмастерье ученик. So they have their reality show called Apprentice Number One, where they invite people to be tested for the position of the apprentice of a very big company. Young people come, they perform all sorts of business works, business activity, and then finally they perform all sorts of tests, and then finally the best of them actually becomes the apprentice with a very good salary.
Take note of from where you have come. The fact that at an early age you never had all these qualifications and all that type of stuff and then went out of the way to train yourself and get yourself back into education and get yourself the job that you've got. That shows me a lot of determination. Chris, you're young, but that could be a good thing. It could be that I have a green shoot. You've shown throughout the course of this 12 weeks some great entrepreneurial ideas. Some of them a bit wacky, and some of them quite good. One of you is going to be very disappointed. I don't worry about the other person because I think that we have two great people here and they're and hold their head up high, whatever. But it's a tough decision, and the decision that I've come to is that Stella, you're hired.
Thank you, sugar.
He's one of the leaders of the. He's the president of a big company. He's Lord Sugar. And this means that sometimes when you work as a simultaneous translator, for example, you need to be able to catch even just the quality of sound like that. And if you don't understand it, this means that you don't understand even the most primitive communication between people. I do not mention even when you need to understand, for example, something that is humorous, something that is based on humor. Let me show you another fragment of the text that is based on humor, and I would wonder whether you would understand it at all. Have you heard of Lord Sugar?
And one of their trademark two-handed interviews here in the ITV studios, exclusively for the South Bank show. Ladies and gentlemen, John Bird and John Fortune.
I will show you just a small fragment. Try to understand why people laugh and whether you would want to laugh also. Listen.
George Parr, you are in an investment banker.
I am, yes.
Yes. And as such, you have your fingers right on the pulse of the financial market.
Yeah, very much so, yes.
And during the summer, there's been a great deal of turbulence and volatility
in the market. Yes. Yes, tremendous.
Yes. And what has caused that?
Well, you have to remember two things about the markets. One is that they are made up of very sharp and sophisticated people who, these are the greatest brains in the world. And the second thing you have to remember is that the financial markets, to use the common phrase, are driven by sentiment.
What does that mean?
Well, things, let's say, are just going along as normal in the market. And then, suddenly, out of the blue, one of these very sharp and sophisticated people says, "My God, something awful's going to happen!"
What do you understand? You understand just emotions, not the words.
Shall I jump out of the window?
Shall I jump out of the window? Exactly. Let's all jump out of the window.
Sell!
We've lost it. Sell!
Yes.
Precisely.
Yes.
Precisely. And then a few days later, this same...
Why are people laughing?
Says, "You know, I think things are going rather well." And everybody says, I
just because of that simple phrase? Because they jump out of the window?
Bye, bye, bye.
Yes. And that's what we call...
But they're also laughing because he's using the word sentiment in a very special way. And he's actually saying in this audience that the market is very often driven by sentiment. But they understand the word sentiment not in the business sense but in the ordinary sense. And then they start explaining the word in the ordinary sense. As a result, part of the meaning is simply lost. I show you these two small examples. There will be more also on Basecamp for you to analyze. Just to show you that in many cases, in order to understand something deeply, you will need to spend hours and hours doing additional research work. This is something that I would expect you to do. I will be giving you business texts for translation and analysis and comment. But each time, I would expect that he will always be doing additional investigation, the search of material. And one of the resources that you are going to use is called Investopedia. Let me show you, and you write it down. You will find there a lot of terms. It's this one. Investopedia. It's one of the best resources today, providing definitions, commentary, analysis of particularly all terminology that is related to investment, to the financial markets, and macroeconomics in general. So, Investopedia. In addition, my expectation would be that beginning with this day, you will start reading two newspapers daily. One of the newspapers is the Russian Vedomosti, You will be reading it daily, every day. Not necessarily buying, you go to their website and read the current issue. And the second paper that you are going to read, please read Financial Times. Also, the site is ft.com. ft.com. Don't read everything. Read only those stories that are related to Russia. Choose anything that is related to Russia, to the oil market or anything. Try to make a fair estimation of whether you understand what is being said there or not. Or is it just a very general vision of the situation without understanding the details? That's important. And when you start writing, make the list of possible terms and words and phrases that you misunderstood. In order to understand these newspapers, and in order to understand all material that is presented here in Investopedia and other specialized resources, you will also have links to them, we need to check whether you have, in general, understanding of what business is. Let us ask you, first of all, about certain basics to see whether you understand what business is. Let us see who of you is going to do business when you actually graduate from the university. Raise up your hands. Those who want to become businessmen or business ladies. Own business and do business. So we have actually, oh, that's good, about six people. That's very good. Six people. Who of you is going to work for business? Oh, the great majority. All right, and who is going to choose the right word. I wouldn't say criticize, but who is going to, I understand that many of you are lawyers. Many of you are lawyers. So lawyers are not actually working for business, but lawyers are doing everything either to support business or to make it collapse very often. Because when you work for some partner who is not displeased with some other business, you will do everything you can to make this business collapse on the basis of the knowledge of the legislation that you have. Okay, so a greater part is going to work for business, but six people are going to do their own business. Let me ask you, those people who think that you are going to do your business, how do you understand business? What sort of thing you are going to do, actually, and what you are going to start with? Any idea? What is doing?
Making something special for people and propose them, sell.
So first you will need to have an idea, then you will need to present this idea to people, and you hope that people will start buying it and eventually you will become rich, little by little, or well off. Is that the idea, vision of business that is shared by everyone in this room? So you have an idea, then...
There's a gap between an idea and selling.
So, again?
A huge gap between... An idea and selling.
And selling.
Something.
Yes, an idea and selling something. How do you know that your idea will generate something that will be used by people, that people in general are going to use it? Remember the business of manufacturing Tamagotchi? Do you remember that? Do you think Tamagotchi is a necessary gadget? Do you think the person who invented Tamagotchi is a great businessman? Probably yes, because it appeared that a lot of people actually need it. And he made billions and billions of dollars. Or, for example, who of you is wearing Pandora on your wrist? You do. Do you need it? Yes? It is not just a bracelet. It's something more important than just a bracelet. Is that right? So you believe in the idea, you do not believe in the idea of a bracelet. You believe in that. You believe in a bigger idea that is called Pandora. Can you explain to me, from your point of view, what sort of idea stands behind Pandora? Emotions? Ah, so you're not wearing just a bracelet. You're wearing emotions on your wrist. Is that right? That's a very interesting idea. Imagine somebody comes up to you, and you are a very wealthy person, right? And then somebody like this girl comes to you and say, you know, I want to start business. Somebody's phone broke. Somebody is calling. Shall I answer the phone? Just switched off. Or shall I send a message? Please call later. На хорошем пути. All right. So imagine you come with your idea to a very rich person, to the banker, and say, look, I have a wonderful business idea. I'm going to produce, what is their idea? I'm going to produce, to manufacture bracelets. Okay. But these are not going to be just bracelets. These are going to be emotional bracelets. Do you believe? Pandora now is worth $1. It's interesting. This company is worth $1. That seemingly stupid idea generated huge capital, huge money. What is it that should be in the words of the person who actually believes in his or her idea in order to start this business? Because if he just goes around with his or her simple idea of manufacturing bracelets that will be expressing a person's emotions, this doesn't sound terribly convincing. It doesn't sound convincing, but you need to add something to that. What? What is that word that should be at the tip of your tongue? It should be at the tip of the tongue, the word that you should always have if you want to start a business of your own, or if you want to sell a business, if you want to convince somebody that your business will be successful.
Maybe that something will be demanded.
Something that will be in demand, okay. Something in demand also has a synonym. This phrase will have a synonym. And this phrase that will be... this phrase, in demand... Need is a very good word, need. But there is another word, a better word that all businesses are actually using.
You mean popular?
Hmm? Very close.
Hmm?
All these words are good, but not the word that is actually the business is using. Hmm? Give me other synonyms for the word necessity. Huh? Necessity, need, want, demand. Huh? Again.
Wish.
But this does not sound. Terribly. Advertisement is an instrument that makes something obvious, something that so that people would be seeing it as an item of demand. Brand again is a consequence. Okay, the word is a good word. So it should be topicality, necessity, demand. Value. So all business is about value. And everything that you said so far is the definition for value. What is value? Just repeat what everybody said. Value is the feeling of necessity, the feeling of need, the feeling of demand, the feeling of topicality, the feeling of necessity, something that is related to brand, something that needs to be advertised. This is value. But there is one more word that better describes the notion of value. Value is usefulness. Value is usefulness. That's what value is. And it's interesting that there are lots of companies in the world whose business is to estimate the value of your business. Can you imagine? People are actually earning billions and billions of dollars on estimating your business. Why do you think it is so popular? Why do you think is the value of the company that is estimating value is so high? Any idea? And do you think, let me give you a simple example. actually, well, I have a pen. I have a pen, okay. And I want to sell it to you. And, well, this is a pen that I'm manufacturing myself, for example. A pen I'm manufacturing myself. So, are you going to buy this? I'm just showing it to you. So, this is a good pen. It writes well. You see, it's a fountain pen. Just good pen, glossy. You see, it's a very good quality. Looks nice, right? Looks like, doesn't, so, well, okay. So this pen is, I want to sell it for how much? Can you give me the, can you give me your price?
$10.
$10. So probably I'm not going to sell it to you for $10. Because it is, now I'm going to use this word, because it is very valuable for me. It is much more valuable for me. I'm using the word value. So it is much more valuable for me than $10. Then your question is, and for how much are you going to sell it? I say, I don't know, probably 5,000 euro. How about that? Are you ready to buy it for 5,000 euro? No? You don't want to ask me questions?
Why?
Yes. You need to ask this question, by all means. You need to ask this question. You say, why? And you need to ask this question because you have in your mind the definition of the word value as usefulness. As usefulness. Therefore, when I give you the price, not the value, but when I give you the price, 5,000 euro, you think in your mind, why? Is it so useful to this person? Is there any special usefulness in this pen that it may cost 5,000 euro? Or so is there anything behind it? I say, well, it writes well. It's a very good brand. So I'm not advertising brands. So but it's a good brand. I have nothing to do with Montblanc. It's Montblanc. So so this is a good fountain Montblanc pen. So something is written here. But the most important thing, that it was given to me as a present by Paul McCartney. You say, oh, are you ready to buy it for 5,000 euro now?
Not our generation.
Can you prove it?
Yes, that's a very good question very good question that may be asked by the company that is actually estimating the value of somebody's business. Just prove it. And I will show you photographs with his pen saying, look, me and Paul McCartney just handshaking and he showing this pen, speaking to the camera, explaining that I'm giving this as a present to Marklen, and this is a Mont Blanc pen, a very good pen that I was using for 20 years and so on and so forth. Do you believe that something that has this brand Mont Blanc will have the same price if it wouldn't have the Mont Blanc brand here? No?
Yes.
So it means...
It's not a brand.
So do you think brand is not a value?
In this particular case.
So you... But are you prepared to use any pen? Any pen in your life? A pen that you're using just from time to time to sign a contract? Do you think that when you are signing a contract, would you like to show off in front of your customer? I say, let me sign this contract. So then you are producing a certain effect, and this effect that you are producing is very important for you, because this will be an indicator of your own wealthiness, of your own. Of your own association with a certain brand that presents itself as a quality brand in the market. Therefore, when you just take this pen and start signing a document, it may be that after signing this document, you would be able to raise the price of your products for the partner with whom you are talking. He will say, oh, not only pen, it may be anything, it may be a suit, it may be a car, it may be a hotel where you are staying. Anything could be the marker, the indicator that you are the person who is doing what? Who is estimating quality, who's valuing quality. So your brand is just a mark, an indication that you are the person for whom quality is a great, great, great issue, is a great item. That's what all brands are doing. So brand is necessary only to raise the value of the items that you have, and at the same time, simultaneously, of you. So every business is doing it. Don't you think that every company that appears in this market and in the world market wants to become a brand? Yes? So many companies want to become brands. How do you understand this wish, this desire, this intention to become a brand? And what is meant by the brand? And how is it related to value? How do you understand this? To be famous, to be known by thousands of people, and so that people would recognize you as a very good provider of the quality, yes?
To be recognized on TV, on newspapers, on magazines, maybe.
Yes, as a result, there will be more sales, right?
Brand will allow you to sell for higher prices.
Yes, then it will also increase the possibility for you to raise the price. Now, we need to compare three words, probably. Price, value, and what would be the third word? And cost. Cost, price, and value. Warren Buffett once said that you buy an item for a price, but you get the value. You buy the item for a price, but you get the value. So, after you buy it, you understand whether it is the item that you've bought is useful for you or whether it is not useful for you. And this usefulness for yourselves is something that you think is a very, very important thing. iPhone. What's the price? What's the price? Approximately.
$600.
Hmm? 5S.
$25,000
rubles. Okay. 6S. More than that. More than that. Is the difference really great? Is the difference really so big that in one case you would pay 25,000 rubles, and in the second case you would buy, you would be ready to pay 35,000 to 40,000 rubles? Is really the value so high that you are prepared to pay 10,000 rubles or 15,000 rubles more? Is it really so? There are people who would be earning 15,000 rubles a month. There are people who would be earning like that, and they will be living the whole month for that. Try not to use any branded items during your life, and you understand that you're not spending so much, really. And at the same time, you will still be quite happy with that, without buying branded things at all. So you are buying branded things because for a great price, because it is related to your reputation. You want to look grand, you want to sound important, you want to look important, you want to be estimated by other people as an important person. That's what all business is about. All business is all about creating value for people, creating usefulness, and then actually transforming usefulness into a religion. Transforming usefulness into a religion. And this religion is called branding. Branding. Many people buy branded things not because they are sure of the quality of this or that stuff, but simply because they think that since it is the brand, the quality will be very, 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 very high. Imagine you are not selling an item like this, but you want to sell a business. Imagine you have a factory that is baking bread, and you want to sell this company to somebody. How to estimate the how to estimate what? You want to find the price for that factory that you have, right? You want to find the price. What do you do? Can you do it by the rule of thumb? Or to check the income that you get? Yes, possible. Yes, that's possible. But and then what do you do? If for example your company generates $1 million a year, for example. Yes, comparison is a very good approach. You're saying, well, let me see how much, but they will not tell you. Because it's a commercial secret. It's a commercial secret. How to estimate the business that you want to sell. A business model. So you need to concentrate on the business, to create a business model. Yes, I think it's a good idea to create a business model to see how the business works. But in general, in order to understand for yourselves how and for what price you are going to sell it, you will probably need to invite somebody who will do it for you, because the parameters that will be accountable in the process of estimating the value of your company will be too many, and very much will depend on your on the future of this business. If you are buying, for example, If it is not a bakery, but if it is, for example, a plot of land somewhere in the outskirts of Moscow, and on this plot of land there is a big building of the former recreation center, Dom Kultury, it doesn't work already. And the person who is selling to you this piece of land, he's saying, well, look, I'm selling to you a piece of land and there is a huge building there. Are you going to sell the building as well? Do you think the possibility exists? Are you going to sell only a piece of land, or are you going to sell a piece of land and that building? What? What is your feeling?
Only land.
Only land. Yes. What shall we do with the building?
Destroy it.
Is it cheap? It's not cheap. So are you going to include it into the price, or are you going to exclude it from the price? It means that you want to sell it with the building, but the buyer would want to sell it to buy it without this building. What will happen? So there is a conflict. There is a conflict. What will happen? You can't sell the land. It means that the buyer who is going to buy it from you, they will probably say, well, first destroy the building, and then I'm going to buy it. So the cost will be, in this particular case, the cost will be on somebody who's actually selling to you to you this land. What we are doing at this moment, I want just to give you the logic of my presentation. What we are doing at this moment, we are trying to understand the essence of business and the essence of doing business. And the first thing that we analyze is value and how value is related to price and cost. How do you understand the word cost? What is cost for you? All expenditures, yes. All expenditures. A cost, and business people even have the jargon for the word cost. Modern Russian business have the jargon for that. And говорят, ну, говорят, нужно бросить кости. But it means that to estimate the costs. They say кости costs. So, all expenditures. This means that the money that you spend may either be used without any profit or with some profit. If the money is spent without any profit, it is expenditures, and these are costs. If the money is spent for the generation of potential future cash, it is called costs on the one hand, and on the other hand, there would be capital. Cost or capital. Cost or capital. So these are by the way very good words, very good two words. So some of the spendings may be expensed, and some of the spendings may be capitalized. For example, who of you pay for your education? Are there people who pay for your education, or your parents probably pay. All right. Is it costs or is it capital? For your parents, it's a cost, and for you. For you, capital. But probably your parents also hope that you will be that you will become a very successful business lady, or maybe a lawyer. I don't know who you are, and a lawyer. So, and they hope that this education that you have will actually is going to generate a lot of money for you, and you will become a very successful lawyer in the future. So, every time the money is spent, you think in terms whether it is the cost or whether it is the capital. This is an important distinction between cost and capital, because depending on this understanding, you will be selling the same item for different price. And because the value would be different depending on whether it is the cost or whether it is the capital. Therefore, when, for example, you are selling a piece of land with a building on it for the purpose of destroying that building, you will probably be buying this piece of land at cost, because for you, this piece of land and this building that is on it maybe is of no importance, because you think that you are going to buy to build a hotel here probably, or you think that you are going to build a swimming pool in this place, and this means that probably the land itself is of no importance. The building itself here is of no importance. You understand that I want to have a swimming pool here. So this means that the whole of it will be the whole landscape will be changed. As a result, you say the only possibility for me to sell this business is to sell it at cost, because the person is not going to use the benefits of that item that I'm selling. But what if I'm selling, for example, this building? It is opposite. If I'm selling this building, and I want to know which usage will be the most profitable for this building, can you give an approximate estimation of what sort of use will be most profitable for this building that is opposite?
Business center.
You think it's a good place for a business center? Yes. So this means that if you desire, for example, suddenly to sell that building, you will probably invite a consultant, and this consultant will be estimating the value of that building as a business center. Do you think it may be sold as a future hotel? Do you think a hotel is possible for that building? Yes, and this building? So this building was first built as a hotel?
Originally.
As a hotel, really?
Yes.
So that's interesting. So
that's why rooms are very small.
Rooms are small, like a hotel room. So it could be used wonderfully for... Do you think it could be used as a hotel now, in this time? No, not so much. And then you will invite a consultant, and you'll say, consultant, please explain to me and write to me in the form of the report what would be the best use for this piece of property, and then he will make the analysis that is called the analysis of the highest and best use. That's a term that is used in real estate. Highest and best use. Can you suggest a Russian counterpart for that? Highest and best use of property. Any ideas about what it could possibly mean in? So highest and best use is наилучшее использование. Анализ. Да, да, да. Анализ наилучшего использования. Анализ наилучшего использования. But then, for example, your consultant writes in your report, in your paper that you are using in order to sell this building, that highest and best use of this building is a hotel, for example. But your potential buyer who will come to you saying, this a hotel? No, I'm not going to use it as a hotel. What do you think a potential buyer could do with this building? He could destroy it. He could demolish it. possibly. In order to do what? In order to do what? To build a new hotel, to build a new building that will be in keeping with modern standards. With modern standards, then he will never buy this building at the value or based on the value that was written in that report as a future or potential hotel. Never, because he will have to undergo the cost of actually demolishing this building and transforming it into a hotel. Or there will be another buyer who will come and say, oh, this is a hotel. Yes, this is a wonderful two-star hotel. So I can use it as a two-star hotel. Then, in that case, the usefulness of this building and its architecture will grow. So the value will grow. As a result, you will be able to sell it at a higher price. And people will be capable of buying it, understanding that they do not need to do anything. These buildings, for example, the only piece of work that should be done here is destroying these desks and organizing, for example, I don't know, a dancing hall here or a canteen in this room or anything. So the value very much depends on the potential future use of this item of the piece of property that is being sold. I'm trying to avoid the word that I should be using here, because I want to ask you, anything that generates cash, or anything that has value for you and potentially can generate cash in business is called, any idea about how it should be called? Any item.
Asset.
Yes, it's an asset. It's an asset. Are you an asset? You personally, are you an asset? You're not owned by anyone, but do you think that you are a potential asset?
Yes.
Do you think I am an asset? Well, at this moment, yes, I am an asset of Moscow State University. That is why you are here, and I'm speaking to you, and you are listening attentively to me. Some of you pay for the education. As a result, the university is getting money from you, and I get my salary. So I am an asset. I have a value for the university, meaning usefulness as a teacher, of somebody who could come to this room at 5 o'clock and pronounce a set of sentences, a series of sentences that will be comprehended by you as a certain theory. Asset. Building is an asset, and this anything that can generate cash will be called an asset. If you want to start a business. You cannot start this business without first buying or purchasing or acquiring certain assets. How are you going to acquire your assets? What do you think is the way to acquire the first assets? First of all, you need to understand what assets you actually need for your business. And then make an approximate estimation of how much money you need actually to buy these assets, in order to help you, and then actually start doing business. How are you going to buy your first assets? Where are you going to take the money for the first asset?
Loan.
You'll go to the bank, and you say.
No, you're
not. Right. You go and sell. So bank, give me money. I have an idea to manufacture bracelets with emotional message to the audience. A business plan. What does the bank want from you? No, in general, eventually, at the end, what does the bank want from you?
Guarantees.
That's what the bank needs from you. The bank needs guarantee from you that you will return the money with interest. Because for the bank, you are the asset. For the bank, you are the asset. Because you are the debtor. Does any bank credit you? Does any bank credit you? Do you take any loan from any bank at this moment? No, you don't. So you don't. But those people who have, but you have an account in the bank. You have a deposit. This means that you are an asset. This means that for the bank you are an asset. That potentially you can generate small amount of money, interest. for the bank. As a result, you are in it. So we are, since we all have the bank cards, we are all assets here. It's interesting that we are all assets here. People who are sitting in this room, and so for the bank, you want to give the guarantee of return that the money would be returned. What do you think the bank logically would want as a guarantee, or as a security, or as a protection of its interest? Property. Yes, property guarantee. So normally, if it is a flat, it will be mortgage probably. It will be mortgage. What else? Mortgage, hypoteca. Mortgage. Because the guarantee of return of the money is the flat where you live. Somebody's guarantee, somebody's trust. It depends on whose guarantee it is. Actually, who gives you? For example, if it is signed by the head of a big company or president of a big company. Again, in this country, I'm not quite sure it will be so easy, because nobody can be a guarantee here in this country. Today you are the president of the company. Tomorrow you don't know where you are. Yes.
Having a constant income.
Yes, could be. You show that you have a business that generates money. This means that the guarantee could be, for example, the guarantee could be the property documents. And in this case, this business that you are owning becomes a guarantee for your loan. As a result, you have a sort of a mortgage scheme, right? All right, but you don't want it. It's so difficult. It's so, well, psychologically and emotionally, it is difficult. You come to the bank, you say, give me $1,000 because I want to start my own business. Then the bank says, what can you give me as a guarantee? You say, I can give you my flat. And then you give your flat, and then your business is not a success. And 5 years later, you understand that you should actually part with your flat, because this was an agreement between you and the bank. So starting a business on the basis of the loan is not a very good idea. It's not a very good idea. Then you think of this, but not in great amount. Not in great amount. You may take a loan for a short-term period, in order to start some sort of small business or buying materials of some sort, manufacturing a specific type of Pandora, I don't know. But what?
Investors.
Venture capital or investors, yes. Investors. Why do you need investors? Because ideally, actually, you are not supposed to return money to the investors. Ideally, you are not supposed. And this means that the investor who is investing in your business, who is investing in your idea, will be twice as attentive to what you are saying. Twice as attentive. Therefore, when I'm saying to somebody, come and invest in my business, I'm going to manufacture bracelets with emotional message to my customers. Give me money for that. Are they going to do it? No. Why not? Why not?
No plan, no motive.
Always try to bring down these high-flown considerations into something more plain. When you have business plan and something, it is too high. Bring it down. Why doesn't the investor want to give you money when you just explain to the investor the idea? The idea may be brilliant. It may be gorgeous.
No guarantees? Yeah.
No guarantees of what?
Of making profit.
Yes, so in addition to the idea, you need to explain
why it is useful,
that's right. Why it is useful where? Society is not the word, it's not the right word. Society, yes, in the society. But society is not the right word here.
Huh?
You need to explain how much money you get.
Where?
Market.
Exactly, in the market. So you need to explain to your potential investor the market. You say, I have the market. And then you will need to show, and then it doesn't matter actually what you sell. You may sell anything. The most stupid item may be sold. As long as the market considers this to be useful. Can you give me examples of the most stupid items or items that are being manufactured today and that is being bought by huge numbers of people, and that is as a result that has value. Any idea? Yes.
There was something like air from different countries.
Air from different countries. In small bottles, right. Yes. You can buy air from Argentina, from Brazil, and so on and so forth. Yes. Any other ideas?
People who stand in queues. For example, if you don't have enough time, you can hire a man who will stand in queues and he'll do everything for you.
Great business idea. Do you think it works? Do you think
yes.
it works? Yes? Mm-hmm. Does it generate a lot of money?
What?
When you want to invest, or when you need an investment, what do you think would be the expectation of the investor when he gives you the money? What would be the expectation of the investor? More money. How much more? Two times. So if he gives you 10 rubles, he's expecting to get 20 from you? No. No, you will never get back the money. You will never give back the money to the investor. No. The business will never, ever give the money back to the investor. That is the most surprising thing. The business will never, ever give back the money to the investor. And what is the money that the what is the term that is used to describe the money that the investor expects? Dividends. Yes. Dividends. In fact, it is the company that decides whether to pay dividends or not to pay dividends. And it's interesting that once Warren Buffett was asked about dividends. He has a company. Warren Buffett has a company, Berkshire Hathaway. It's a big investment company. One of the biggest in the world. And one day he was asked about whether he ever pays dividends. He said, no. He said, and if I ever pay dividends, probably I was either sleeping or taking a shower. Even one of the biggest investors think that it is not a very good idea to pay dividends. Why? Why is it not a very good idea to pay dividends? It seems to be so lawful. You give money to somebody, so you expect the company to be profitable, and part of the profits that the company is generating could be given to you.
You reinvest.
Yes, you reinvest, actually. Yes, you want this business to grow. Therefore, the profits, the actually net money that is at the end, after all costs actually are covered, we shall be discussing it later on, will be reinvested back into this business. You will be setting up more offices, opening new branches and so on and so forth, so your business will be growing. So actually, ideally as the owner of the company, I would prefer not to pay dividends at all. Well, I might, because I want to be kind to my investors. But actually, there is something more than every investor expects. And you can logically guess what they expect. More than that. More than dividends,
much.
Yeah, using your idea is right, but you're using the wrong words.
Price over business.
The what?
Over business or company.
What?
Price.
The market value, not the price, because you don't know the price. You know what the price is, but the value, yes. So every investor, when he or she is giving money to somebody, just to some company, his expectation is not that he will get money, those small pieces of income that is generated by this particular company. He is thinking of the whole value of business where he invested. Why? Because he hopes that maybe 5 or 6 or 7 years later, he will be able to sell his share in your business, and that sale will generate for him more money than just dividends. Do you get the idea? How do you sell your business to different investors? What is the way to sell the business? What do? He comes to you and then he says, well, I want to be one of the owners of your business. And how do you actually sell it? well, you own the business. Then the person comes, well, I want to be your investor. I say, okay, come. How does it actually happen? What sort of guarantee is there between you and the investor that now he owns the company? And how much of the company, right? No? It's called shares. It's called shares. Why is it called shares? It's called shares because the whole company is broken into pieces. The whole company is broken into pieces. Therefore, when you are selling a share of your company, a small piece of your company. That is why it is called a share. Otherwise stated, stock. Stock is just the paper that has reference to a share. Okay. So you are selling a share. How much of your company are you prepared to sell to an investor? If you,
49.
Not more than 49%. Because if he or she owns more than 49%, then it is called controlling stock. And this means that he will have an opportunity now to dictate to you what to do or what not to do. So, as a result, if that person gets a paper from you saying that he owns the company, a paper, how can he prove that the paper is not fake? How can he prove that the paper is not fake if he wants to sell? He owned your company for 5 years without getting in any dividends. He gave you, I don't know, $1 million. And he wants his $1 million back, and then he wants to sell it to somebody. How can he prove to the potential buyer that his ownership is lawful? How is it done? Any idea about the procedure of the way it is done? Something that is called the shareholder agreement. Shareholder agreement, so there is an agreement with you, then this agreement states that you have such and such number of shares of your capital, and this shares is registered by the state. The state registers you as the owner of this particular business. So and there is the registry. Registry is registering, so that you, Ivan Ivanovich Ivanov, is the owner of 25% and such a business. In fact, it can be even a shareholding without any paper. It can be just there in the registry. And you say, yeah, I own 25%. But in fact, you will not open any material document proving it. It will be just registered somewhere in the registry. There is a special organ that is registering this. And therefore, if you want to get your money back, where do you go? How do you find a potential buyer for your 25% that was worth $1 million last time? Where? You may go to the investment bank, but normally you are going to the market. You are you are going to the market. What is the name for the market that is selling stock, or that is selling shares? What is the name of the place where shares are being sold? Bursa. Exchange. Stock exchange. It's called stock exchange. Birja. You go to the stock exchange and you offer. Through the investment bank, you offer it at the stock exchange, and hopefully, because the value of the company is indexed, because the value of the company may be growing or falling, you may be buying and selling companies. Today you can open a piece of Gazprom. Tomorrow you may own a piece of Rosneft. The day after tomorrow you may be owning a piece of Tatneft, and you may be working with your portfolio. All the time seeing what the value of the company is. Today the value is one, tomorrow's value is another, but the whole amount of shares that is being sold at a price today in that market is called, do you know the word for that? If we put together every share that is being sold today at the stock exchange for this company, collectively it is called capitalization. It is called market capitalization. And this explains what is meant by, for example, when one company is very successful today, it is worth, let's say, $3 billion today. But tomorrow, because, I don't know, the president was imprisoned, or because your business was not, has lost its value for the company, it may suddenly lose its capitalization. Actually, it doesn't lose anything. It's simply that people do not want to buy your shares anymore. In that particular case, the capitalization may fall sometimes, even below a very, I don't know, $1 billion or maybe less. So, as a result of you observing how the market works, you will have general vision of the market capitalization, your potential for buying or selling shares. I think I will stop here. I understand that you are already a bit sleepy. It may be interesting, but a bit complicated. Do you have any questions to me? Is everything clear? Yes. Okay. So please get registered, and I will start giving you tasks during this semester. There will be about 8 tasks in base camp. You perform all these 8 tasks in base camp. You publish it there, and at the end of the semester, on the basis of these 8 tasks that you perform, you will get your test. That's it. Thank you.